All right.
This is going to be a little bit on improvised fashion. We're not going to use the over projector just because I think it's easier to see. And I would like to let our distinguished panel do the speaking when they have something that they'd like to say. But I do have a few questions, and first of all, I'd like to get started by introducing myself. My name is Bill Degnan, and I'm one of the vice presidents of the Mid-Atlantic Retro Computing Hobbyists. And I'm very pleased to be here and to have a distinguished panel. And I'd like to just quickly introduce who we have to be our panelists. And then we're going to have some questions, and they're going to be targeted questions that have to do with the early microcomputing in New Jersey and beyond in the 70s-ish, early 80s period, which is the topic of our discussion. If I think of anything, I'll just add it as I go. We put these questions together over the period of the past couple of days with Evan Koblenz and myself, and hopefully this will work. This is the first time we've done something like this. And we'll open up the questions at the end if anyone has anything they'd like to add. So first we're going to start by introducing our guests. Make sure I've got the information properly. We've got David Ahl, who's right here, and many of you know him from Creative Computing. We've got Roger Amidon from TDL, Xitan, and Epson. And Dick Moberg, the founder of the PAX. Larry Stein, the Computer Mart, and John Dilks, PC76. So now what I'd like to do to start with is I'd like to give each one of you a chance to make an opening comment about what you feel, describe in your own words, generally what your interest was and what you were doing and what you feel to be as your accomplishment in the era of the mid-70s to early 80s.
Well, thank you. And I'd like to also thank you for organizing this session, give you a chance to see some old friends. And we're all still alive. That's good, right? Well, I had just gotten out of, I was an engineering student at the Moore School at Penn in Philadelphia. And during my senior year, I started working for a neurosurgeon because I was interested in medicine. So I was working for a neurosurgeon in spinal cord injury research, and we're trying to figure out how do you cure that or how do you deal with it? Well, you can't really cure it, so how do you deal with it? So at the same time, I was interested in computers and got very early interested in microcomputers back in the early 70s, and was thinking, well, maybe what you could do is sort of make people walk again by using a computer to do what the brain does with locomotion and walking. So it was a pretty far out idea and still hasn't been done, but that was, I was sort of young and naive and motivated, and that's what I decided to do. So the question is, where do you go to get this information? Well, as we all know, back in the early 70s, there wasn't a whole lot of sources for information. So I would read the normal magazines like Dr. Dobbs and other esoteric magazines, and I saw that there was really no group in the Philadelphia area, and there was starting to be a few of them around in other areas that of people that could come together and share their knowledge. So I said, well, we should have one in Philly, and so I think I put an ad, I don't know, was Byte around back then? I guess it was back in the day. Yeah. Okay, so it was in either one of the first issues of Byte or it was what in like Dr. Dobbs or one of those, saying, anyone interested in the Philly area, give me a call. And so we ended up in, I think the first meeting was in June of 76. So we had a meeting that about, I think, 50 to 60 people showed up, and then it just grew from there. So, and that was the Philadelphia Area Computer Society, and next weekend they're having their 35th anniversary, so they're still going strong down there. So that's sort of my story. And
we're going to come back to that, some questions about that as well.
If you don't mind, I'll stand up because I have a couple of things to show and tell. Actually, the first thing I want to mention, I was at DEC, Digital Equipment Company, and some of you may know Ken Olson just died very recently. And in fact, today is the day of his memorial service at Gordon College. I have a preview of the little bulletin about it. And like me, Ken, later in his life, became a Christian. And I'd just like to read one of his favorite scriptures, because it's mine also. And this is just kind of in remembrance of Ken Olson, the founder of Digital Equipment. We'll have our own little very brief memorial service here. And this is from Isaiah 40, verse 28 to 31. Do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He will not grow tired or weary, and his understanding no one can fathom. He gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak. Even youths grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. Thank you, Ken. Briefly, when I was at Digital, and this is kind of the predecessor or led into creative computing, we published a little magazine. I was in the educational division there, and we published a magazine called Edu. And it went to schools and colleges who were using computers, had programs, simulations, just tips on how to use the computer. And that's kind of the forerunner of creative computing. The other thing I did at Digital is I collected material from high schools and colleges using computers, games specifically, and published a book called 101 Basic Computer Games. This is the first printing from Digital Equipment. When I left DEC, they decided they had to get more serious, and so they came up with this really catchy cover. I then made a deal with them to continue to publish the games, but convert it into Microsoft Basic, and so sort of didn't really infringe too much on DEC, and we had a good working relationship. And this was the first Microsoft version of Basic Computer Games. The one that you're probably most familiar with is this one. And this has the distinction of being the first computer book to sell 1 million copies. Now you think I got a lot of the royalties? No. It went into publishing Creative Computing. This was the very first issue of Creative Computing. At that time, I had a circulation of 600, almost. Not quite, but almost 600. Some landmark issues. This was our first glossy cover issue 2 years later. This was the first issue where it was actually two magazines in one. The back was, and this was an April Fool's issue, Dr. Kilobyte's Creative Popular Personal Recreational Microcomputer Data Interface World Journal.
Let's move on, just to keep things flowing.
We made, and our 10th anniversary issue, Bill Gates had a lot of stuff in there, our final issue. A bunch of other things. Today, I went on to buy a different magazine, an entirely different field, military vehicles. Anybody restoring a military vehicle? I can tell you how to do it. Now I sold that, and I today develop and teach Bible studies.
Thank you. Bible study. Just really quick, let's see if we get to the questions. But please.
Hi. All right, Roger Amidon here. I got involved with computers from the hardware standpoint. I was always involved with electronics ever since I was a kid and built a lot of electronic stuff. And I guess it was in 1972-ish, there was a Skelby, was it called, with the 8008, you know. And I got involved with that a little bit, playing with it. But then there was an issue of Popular Electronics that came out in December of, what was it, 73?
74.
December 74. That's right. And although it didn't really have an impact until January, but it came out in December, and it had a picture of the Altair. And it sounded really cool, so I ordered one. Yeah. I couldn't afford it with the case, so I ordered it without the case. It was a kit, you know. But it was pretty cool. And that summer, I was going around to different ham fests with a guy that was selling 7400 logic ICs. If you remember 7400,
yeah.
It was a great thing that TI did. Matter of fact, the TI book on 7400s was like a Bible, and very well done, you know, compared to today's books, which are terrible. But that summer, I put up a sign at the booth saying, anyone have an Altair? See me. I had an Altair. And I got a lot of response from that. Also, there was the ACGNJ, which was Sal Levy's, who we were hoping would be here, but he couldn't make it. And he had started a club. So I went to the very first meeting they had. And as a matter of fact, I was the first person to ever give a talk at the ACGNJ. And the talk was how to interface a teletype to your Altair, you know, with a UART. And it was a very popular talk. A lot of people built it and were able to talk to their Altair, which was pretty cool. I remember when I first got the Altair, I had 256 bytes of memory. And I was able to talk to it with my teletype, but I had to bit switch that program in. And then, of course, once I did that, I didn't have a lot of bytes left to do anything with it, you know. I could run a little program that flashed the lights in the front, but that was about it. So I took my next paycheck and blew the whole thing on more memory. And I bought 3 more K of memory. So I had 4K of memory, you know. I'm sorry, no, 1K. 4 more chips, whatever. All I know is I went from 256 to 1K. And it was like, to go from 256 to 1K was like amazing. Look at all the room I had. And I was able to actually write a program that would do something in my 1K of memory. And then eventually I did get a 4K board. They came out with a 4K board. If you remember, that 4K board was horrible. It was dynamic, and it would forget all the time. It would drop bits left and right. But at any rate, so that's how I got involved with the computer side of things and software. I got involved with software because I had hardware experience, but in order to make the hardware do what I wanted, I had to learn software. So I started right at the bit switch mode. I learned octal. Anybody remember octal?
Oh, yeah.
The original Altair used octal. And then I learned hex, hexadecimal. But at any rate, I realized that with all this interest in the Altair, what we needed was not a ham fest, we needed a computer fest. So I had this idea of having a computer fest. Now, at the time, I was living in a place called Skillman, New Jersey, and I was in a house that had a huge field that was not being used, a big open field. So I had this great idea of having a computer fest at my house in this field. And I had a friend of mine over named Al Katz from Trenton College, somebody I've known ever since I was a kid. And he said, you can't have it in the field. What happens if it rains? It'll get all muddy. Why don't we have it at the college, Trenton State College? And I said, yeah, that's probably a good idea. From that point on, suddenly, Sal Levy gets involved with Al. Alan calls Sal and says, we're going to have a computer fest at the college. You want to be a part of it? And the next thing I know is that Alan and Sal are credited with the first computer fest. I said, wait a minute. What was my idea? And I never got credit for it, which has been a bug up my butt. But anyway. And then the first computer festival at the college is what led to other things happening. It was at the beginning of a lot of this stuff, and it was pretty cool. I went on and did a lot of other things. The Epson QX10, anybody remember that? That was the penultimate 8-bit computer at the time. It could hold up to 256K of RAM. Most computers were 64K, if you remember, and we had a bank switching mechanism. So you could have 4 banks of 64K, And you could do a lot in that. We came up with something called Valdox, which was actually like Microsoft Office, but before there was an office, you know. We had a calculator spreadsheet kind of thing. We had drawing programs, word processor that was amazing. There were things you could do in that word processor that you still can't do in Word. You know, like you could take a bunch of text here, move it here, column-wise, you know, circle it, move it. You could take a list of figures and then point here and say, total that, put the total here. It was an amazing word processor. The only problem was it was running on an 8-bit machine and it was using floppies, 5 1/4-inch floppies. Anybody remember 5 1/4-inch floppies? So it was a little bit on the slow side, but otherwise it was a great product. And that lasted until 85, 86. It was steamrolled by the IBM PC, mainly because it was IBM, the 800-pound gorilla. And Epson was a small Japanese company, and they really didn't know how to compete well. So the IBM kind of took over that space. At one point, we wanted to move Valdox over to the IBM, but it was considered that IBM was the competitor. Why would you want to do that? Put your product on the competitor's hardware, you know. But then eventually Epson decided to do that outside of us.
Well, let's move on to Larry.
Yeah, and I guess this would be a good time. But just to let you know, QX10 was one of my major contributions.
I think we're going to run out of wire.
Well, that's fine. That's fine.
Hi, I'm Larry Stein, and Roger sort of stole half of my story.
There you go.
I went to school and have a degree in mathematics. And when I was about to get married, I asked one of my college professors, what should I do? And he said, you got to become a programmer. And I said, right, what's a programmer? This was in 1963. I didn't know about computers. I had no computer classes. And fortunately for me, I went to work for Blue Cross in Newark. They sent me to IBM school to learn programming, and I took to it like a duck takes to water. And as I changed jobs and life went on in the early 70s, I'd been dreaming about having a 1401 computer in my basement. The fact that it ran on, 223 phase, I was ready to do that. And the fact it was bigger than my basement, well, we could make some adjustments. I loved this computer. Pardon me?
Walkout basement or what?
No, not a walkout basement.
It would have
had to become a walkout basement. But I just loved the whole concept of computers and what they could do. I just had to have one. A couple of years later, one of my friends came over to my house with parts to build a monitor. And we built a monitor. And he was working for a company that was servicing some very, very early digital computers. In fact, one that had, for memory, it had a hard disk drive was its memory, not its storage. I forget the name of the computer. And we got this doctor who owned it to let us put a modem on it so we could call into it. And that became the beginning of satisfying this need for a computer. And like Roger said, in December of 74, when Les Solomon wrote about the Altair computer in Popular Electronics, I can't explain what my feeling was. And the kit was $499, but if you did some research, you found out that the 8080 chip that came with the kit was $380, $395 in single quantities. I mean, so how could you go wrong?
Yeah.
You buy the chip and you get the whole computer and you just have to solder it together. But I didn't do that quite yet. I was still on the fence because I didn't have $500. But I was still playing around with my monitor on this computer and doing some time sharing with my teletype machine. I had a neighbor that offered to pay me to write a program for him that did some kind of calculations for his business, and he paid me $1,000, and I did it. And about that time, the IMSI, which is a competitor to Altair, came out. It was much more robust, and to become a dealer, you had to send him $1,000. Which I happened to have. And I told Gladys, my wife, I said, we're going to the computer business. I won't make it too long, but one other main thing happened to me during that time period is one of my ham radio friends said he was going to go get a board for his computer. I said, where are you going to get a board for your computer? Because he said, well, there's a computer store in McLean, Virginia. I'm flying down there. You want to come? I said, yeah. He had a light plane. So I drove up to, Somerville or whatever, and we flew down to Washington, and we walked into Russell, whatever his name was, and his beautiful wife, computer store, which was an office above a shopping center, like two rooms. And if you walk in, I see there's almost as many people as here. They were waiting in line because he had just gotten his shipment of Altair boards, and they were waiting in line to get the parts that they had ordered. Anyway, after a long day, I got home and I said to my wife, I said, I'm sure we're in the business now, because I just saw what a real computer store was. There were no product, no computers built, nothing. So I bought my first MSI, or ordered my first MSI, and that same day, one of my ham radio buddies called me up and he said, I hear you're going to the computer store business. I want to buy one. I said, for what? You know, for doing this and doing that. I said, okay. And he came over and he handed me $1,000 as a deposit. Next thing happened is I went to a course that Roger was teaching in 8080 assembly language, because I had to learn that. And I'm sitting in class, and the guy next to me, his name was Jack Shearing, worked in Broadway renting sound equipment, showed me an invoice or proposal he got from the computer store in Boston. So he's going to buy this Altair computer. I said, I can make you an M-size twice as good as that. This is the same, you think I'm making a story up. He reached in his pocket, he took out 10 $100 bills, handed them to me, and I wrote him a receipt on a piece of yellow paper. He said, build it. He became one of my really, really, really good friends over the years. I came home from school that night, and I threw the money at my wife, and I said, we're really in business now. And that's how I started. I opened a computer store in my basement in 1975. It was very, very homey. And after a couple months, we outgrew the basement, and we're now up in the rec room. And Gladys comes home one day, and she sees us in the rec room. There's a big box on the floor. It's a CompuColor 19-inch color computer. And there's a big guy who was as high as the CompuColor, one of my good customers who weighed 450 pounds, laying on the floor because he was from New York. But he called CompuColor. He said, I'm the only guy that had one on the East Coast. He came over, and he bought one. And it just went from there and on and on and on. It changed my life. Microcomputing changed my life because I was also into electronics and a ham radio operator. This gave me a chance to explore both things, and I'm still doing it. One last thing I'll tell you. My first computer had 256 bytes of memory also. Had no input-output except for the 16 front panel switches. In order to put a program in, you set up to hit, enter. Set up stuff, enter. Enter next. And you could bit switch in a program that might make the lights flash on the front of the computer. And thanks to one of our early buddies, he wrote a program that would cause enough interference in an AM radio. You put it on the computer, it would go like, that was supposed to be Clementine. That was our first IO device. And then Roger taught me how to connect my teletype to my machine. I thought I had died and gone to heaven because now I had paper tape. And we were very lucky to live through that revolution where every month there was something new. And we were learning as it was going along. And we were fortunate to be there to see it happen, to live through it. And my 256K memory board, 256 byte memory board was about this big. S100 bus board, it plugged in. This is my 64 gigabyte iPad.
Good afternoon. My name is John Dilks, and I started the personal computing show in Atlantic City. Unlike the gentleman here, I didn't go to college. I went to work for the Bell System Western Electric. And Western Electric was in the 1960s developed an electronic switch, which became the heart of the Bell System. And because I, too, am a ham radio operator,
they thought that maybe my ham radio background would really be a good thing to have to learn how to install and test this new telephone system. They seemed to think that you had to know a lot of electronics to work on computers, and we all found out later a logical mind worked better than a lot of electronics. But we had our good times. And I went to a lot of really good expensive schools with Western Electric, and in the 1960s, I decided I wanted to have a home computer. And so I started saving transistors because we use transistor diode logic. And I started getting diodes, and I'd buy transistors on sale. And I had a few hundred, and I was going to make some kind of an accumulator or something. And I didn't have anything to make a printed circuit board. And then Carl Helmers came out with a magazine prior to Byte. I forget the name of it, but he had featured a computer in there, which was an 8008 chip. And I thought, geez, you know, and in the meantime, I had been saving ICE integrated circuits, deciding to use those instead of transistors. And when Carl came out with this, there was somebody that had a kit, and I'm thinking I'd really like to buy one, but I had just built a new house, and I was stuck with the old house for a while, making double house payments, so I didn't really have any extra money. And then while I'm waiting and reading everything, Byte magazine came out, and I was a charter subscriber, and reading every issue cover to cover, and decided that I had to have a computer. And then somebody came out with a wire wrap kit for the 8080 chip. And I think Larry said, or Roger said, was almost $400 for that chip. And I said, well, the 8080 is better than the 8008, so I should get one of those. And I could buy this wire wrap kit and put it together. Well, I didn't have the money, and I procrastinated and waited a little while. And I called this Byte magazine started running the ads for the Altair and the MSI. I was trying to decide which one would be the better one. So I called Carl Helmers at Byte, and I asked him for his opinion. And I said, where is there a computer store I can go see one? I was only thinking of myself at the time. I wanted to have a home computer. He said, well, I heard there's a rumor that somebody started one on the West Coast. And he said, that's a little too far for you to go. So I said, well, how about a any of these computer conventions or anything around where I could go see one? Because I had snuck into the Spring Joint Computer Conference a couple years earlier in Atlantic City and registered for every computer magazine that was in the show. And I used to get the design, electronic design and datamation and some of those. And I would read those cover to cover. So all the time I'm educating myself, and at work, I'm working on all these circuits, testing the telephone system and getting better at it and know how to use a scope and everything. Finally, the old house sold and I had a little extra money. And about that time, Carl Helmers and I decided that we should have a national computer show. He thought it would be good for the magazine. And he said, see if you can find somebody in Atlantic City that would run it for us. So I knew a guy who owned a hotel, and I went and told him this great idea I had, took some Byte magazines with me. I said, here you are, run this computer show, and everybody will come to it. And he said, well, I don't run shows. He says, we have them at our hotel, but somebody else should run it. He said, here's some of the local companies. So I called everyone on the phone, and basically they said, don't call us, we'll call you. So I went back to Carl, and I said, I'm having trouble finding somebody to run it. And Carl says, well, if you'll run it, I'll back you as far as getting exhibitors and everything, and it should go. So I went back to the guy at the hotel, and he said, sure, if you want to run the computer show, we'll do it. And he says, I'll give you a hand. He says, I promise you, if you don't make any money, I won't charge anything. He says, the best I'll get out of it is rent a few rooms. And so with that and about $20 in my pocket, we started the computer show. So I went back to Carl Helmers and told him about it. And he said, oh, this is great. He says, I've already talked to a few people. And they want to come and talk to some of the West Coast people. We can get them to come out. And about the next month, he calls me on the phone and he told me, you know, there's one coming up in Trenton, New Jersey, I just heard about. And I said, gee, that's pretty close. I'll go to it. Had I known the Trenton Computer Fest was going to be there, I would have never gone into the computer show business because it was nothing but a lot of work. Long story short, I went to Trenton Computer Fest, had a wonderful time, met these gentlemen. We all got to become pretty good friends over the years, and I continued to work for Western Electric, and in my spare time I ran a computer show. So I also joined the amateur computer group in New Jersey, which I didn't know about when this whole thing started, and I went to one of their meetings, and there was a guy there named Art Fowler who said he was a dealer for M-Size. I don't know if Larry had had it at the same time.
No, he came out way after us.
He came after you?
He was way after.
Was he? Yeah. Well, he was the first guy I met that...
Oh, yeah. He had an electronics store, and he took on some distributors.
So, three of my buddies, we decided we're going to buy M-Size. And I think we were the first three sales that he had. And we each bought an M-Size, and I had 256-byte memory also, which I was thrilled with. And I'll just jump over to that story quickly.
That's fine. I was actually going to say, why don't you go ahead and compare the Trenton Computer Festival and your Atlantic City show.
Okay, but I just got to finish this about the computer. If any of you have seen an MSI computer, they're beautiful. They're blue. They got a black panel, red lights, and it just fired us all up when back in those days everybody wanted one. And so I bought this computer from Art Fowler with a 256-byte memory. I spent two or three nights wiring it together. When I was working on the memory, I was worried about static, stripped down to my shorts, wet myself down to make sure I wouldn't have any static electricity. I stuffed the board, worked on the memory board, and ready to test the computer for the first time. And I fired it up and it worked, and I toggled in a program that if I did the data switch one, the data light one would work, and so forth. And I was all excited. It took me three or four times to toggle it in, but it was running. And I called my wife, and this is the reason she's not here. She knew I would tell this story. I said, come out, look at this. And the computer's sitting there, and you could hear the fan running. And I says, watch this. And I lifted the switch, and the light came on. And I closed the switch and the light went off. And then I did it to a couple of more. And she says, what? All that money and all that stupid box does is turn on a stupid light? Well, that was good thing I didn't have a gun with me at the time. So now I had a computer, and the rest is history. As Larry said and Roger said, every month was exciting. I subscribed to every magazine out there. Every magazine had its ups and downs as far as good things to look at. And when a new magazine came out, we'd read it cover to cover and try to do things. Programs back then, now you had to write your own, or the magazine started printing them, and you could toggle them in the front. And my first printer was a 5-bit ball dot teletype. And I wrote a program to convert. Wrote a program to convert 8-bit to 5-bit. And I had a printer. I was the only guy in the whole neighborhood. Because back then, printers were pretty expensive if you wanted to buy one. So now compare Trenton to the Atlantic City Personal Computing Show. Trenton was a great thing. It was exciting. It was the first time that they did it. It was the first time I did it. I learned some things from going to the Trenton Computer Fest. I saw some good things and bad things. Never run a computer show before, or any show. And I sat down with two good buddies, Jim Main and Dave Jones. And the three of us put this thing together, and we worked on it. Our wives worked with us. And with the hotel owner, he made some suggestions, and we put it together. The whole thing, the big point I want to make is I never would have had a personal computing show in Atlantic City if I had known about the Trenton Computer Fest, because all I wanted was a computer. And I figured, well, if I have to run a show so I can find a computer, I'll do it. Well, I had my computer by the time of the show.
I'm glad you didn't know.
How about if I pass this on to somebody else?
Sure, I have plenty more questions. You've actually, the flow is great, and you've touched upon a lot of the things. That's great. I was curious, was it a more of a commercial? Was Trenton more commercial, or yours was specifically commercial? Or was that not really the focus?
It was, the whole industry was non-commercial at the time. It was hobby. And if you wanted to build a computer that back then, because that's the only way you could get one, you had to know how to do it. Well, ham radio operators knew how to build things. And that's why the three of us got involved with the computers, because we knew how to build things and how to make things.
I want to make two comments. One is about, I was at the first Trenton Computer Festival, and it was very non-commercial. It was held in the hallways of the college. The hallways were about maybe 5 feet wide, and exhibitors like myself, we had a table against the wall, and I brought a computer, and I brought a color video card made by Promemco called the TV Dazzler.
Oh, yeah.
And it was running the program of life, which was the only thing it could do, or I could make it do. And it was amazing. People saw that, and they just had to have that. It's just another toy. But the show itself was very, very unorganized. They had some talks and stuff, but it was tough to navigate. John's show, 6 months, 4 months, 5 months later at the Shelburne Hotel in Atlantic City, that was like a real trade show. And we exhibited there also. And you had a table, we had a skirt on our table, and we had, programs running and things going on. And I won't bore you with the details, but we were the only people, Computer Mart of New Jersey, that had a computer set up to actually record the names and addresses of the attendees that came to our booth. Program that somebody wrote, and it actually worked like a data processing program where it wrote records and you could read them back and everything. No one had that because we didn't have disk drives back then. It's all done on cassette tape. It was great. I was going to say something else, but I could talk all day. The two shows, though, were the John's show. I met Steve Wozniak there. He was there. And
Joe Wozniak
story.
Amazing. Please go ahead.
Yeah. Yeah, this is another classic event in my life. I had been selling something called the Apple Monitor through his store.
Yes.
And what it was for the Altair 8080, and it was a 2K prom, and it resided in the upper end of the address space, and it was mainly an I/O monitor and a debugger.
It meant the end of bit switching.
Right. When you first turned on the machine, you were in this Apple monitor, you could view your memory, you could load memory with stuff, you could put it in byte by byte, or you could fill up range of memory with stuff. You could also read a paper tape, one of the things it had, and the tape was in hexadecimal in the Intel format, remember?
And also binary.
And binary, you could do it that way too. The whole idea was that it took a lot of the I/O out of the picture, so it made it invisible to the program. So when you wrote a program, which would reside in the lower end of memory, when you needed a character from the console, you called a vector up in the Apple. When you needed to put a character to the console, the same thing. When you needed a printer, in other words, all your I/O was handled by this monitor.
I got to interrupt for 1 second.
Sure.
It's hard to appreciate it in these days, but back in those days, this was one of the most amazing things that helped further computing, because now you had something in your computer that would allow you to do all the input-output without you writing it in assembly language.
Or writing it for each different device that was out there.
And this was a major breakthrough. It helped in our business. It helped us to be able to sell computers that people could go home and turn on. Otherwise, they couldn't turn them on without doing all the bit switching. Right. That was a major breakthrough.
It was. The Apple monitor was a cool thing. Now, at this City Festival, at one point, I'm sitting in the dining area, eating a hot dog, and these two guys come over. You Roger Amidon? Yeah. And they sat down, and it was Wozniak and Jobs. And they said, listen, we've heard about your Apple monitor. Could you do us a favor and change the name of your monitor? And I said, why would I want to do that? You know. Well, we started a small company out in California called Apple Computing.
Okay.
And we have this computer we're going to be trying to sell called the Apple Computer, you know. And I said, is that one I saw at that booth? Isn't that 6502 based? And he goes, yeah. I said, well, my Apple monitor is an 8080 based program. So there's obviously no confusion there. I said, I'll tell you what. If people call you up, ask them if they have an 8080 or a 6502. If they have an 8080, give them my phone number. Or Larry's, you know. And if it's a 6502, fine. I'll do the same. Anybody calls me about a 6502, I'll give them your number, you know. And we made this agreement to not change the name of my Apple monitor. Now, if I had some foresight.
So is this Apple monitor? Does Apple
that was what came later with the Z80.
Mm-hmm. And is that new?
When we did the Z80 board, see, the Apple monitor existed before the Z80. Mm-hmm. That was for the Altair. And it worked great for that. But when we did the Z80 board, I wanted to redo my monitor and add some of the extra power of the Z80. And I was able to add a lot more features in the monitor, as well as doing breakpoints with all the additional registers in the Z80. But I wanted to make sure there was no confusion, so I spelled a Z in front of Apple. Mm-hmm. I called it Zapple. Yeah. And then we came out with the Zapple monitor, which was sold by my company, Technical Design Labs, out of Princeton. And so that's where Zapple came from. But Apple was the monitor that made a lot of improvement, like he was saying, in people's ability of using the computer, because there was a whole variety of ways of talking to it. People had standalone keyboards, they had tall type model 33s, they had Bordeaux machines, you know, 5-bit. But whatever your I.O. device was, you made it work with the Zapple monitor, or Apple monitor in this case, and then you could write a program and it would work on anybody's machine, because as long as they had Apple, it ran. It was a great breakthrough.
Did they have, at the time of the Trent Computer Festival and Land 76, when did you and your group stop calling it an Altair bus and start calling it the S100 bus?
Oh, I can tell that story.
The S100?
When did that transition occur? Among you and then...
Well, it was basically because we had a lot of products that fit in the same bus, but we didn't want to call it the Altair bus because that was our competitor, so...
Leading up to PC76, we were having trouble getting the West Coast guys come to the show. It was expensive to fly back then. They didn't have these cheap flights like they do today. And most of these guys were working in garages or cellars and didn't have a lot of extra money. Every penny that they could get, well, they would put into their products and were trying to sell them through the computer club in California. And there was a guy in California started a magazine called Interface Age. And some of these I brought extras and they're out on the for sale table out there. I donated them to the club along with some PC t-shirts that I had left over. So you can, if you buy them, the money goes to the club here. Anyway, Bob Jones put together with somebody he knew in travel business, a flight from California to Philadelphia to bring everybody over, and it was a cheap flight. They leased the airplane or something like that. Anyway, it was a whole lot cheaper than buying regular tickets. So we got quite a few people signed up, Processor Tech and some of those other companies out there, and John French, I forget the name of his company.
John French was the 16-bit clone of the deck.
Oh yeah.
What was that called?
Well, anyway, so we got a bunch of people lined up to come, and a lot of that was responsibility of Carl Helmers, because I had given him the information, and when he would talk to these people for Byte Magazine to sell advertising or whatever they were doing, he would tell them about it. And we found out that Jobs and Wozniak wanted to come, but they were really tapped out financially. They had every penny that they had between them tied up in their business. What we didn't know at the time, they were developing the Apple II. And they were selling the Apple I, which was pretty much a bare-bones kit.
The Apple I, frankly, for a second. this meeting with Jobs and Wozniak, I had seen the Apple One at their booth. And when they told me they were starting this computer company in California called Apple, I figured, they're not going to go anywhere with that. It was a piece of junk compared to what we were doing, you know, compared to the IMSI and the Altair. It was nothing, really. And I thought, they're not going to be successful. Who cares? Apple. Big deal. And then they came out with the Apple II. And I went, uh-oh. What a big difference, you know?
I'm going to just change gears a little bit, just to talk to this side of the room a little bit. Speak, but related to this question, I'm going to read a quote to you, Dick, and you can tell me what you think of this. This is actually something that David Ahl had in his Creative Computing in September of 1976. And the quote is, this is Lou Fields, who was the president of the Southern California Computer Society, who wrote Information Age. But I think if you want to know where the most important area in the country for members and microcomputer activities, I say Philadelphia. It's not California, it's Philadelphia. That was a quote from your magazine. So I wanted to ask you, was the Southern California Computer Society involved in the formation of the Philadelphia Area Computer Society, PACS? Who was there? I mean, you already talked a little bit about the first meetings, but I know that there was a Southern California Computer Society group in Philadelphia. Were some of those members, did they migrate over, or were they involved in this? And maybe you could tell us a little bit about the groups that were active just before your group, and then how that came together, and whether any of those migrated over and consolidated into yours, or whether yours was more of a spontaneous group that worked independently. Were you influenced by California, or did you feel that that was not necessarily even, you know, on the radar?
Well, there was a lot going on back then, but I don't think it had any influence. It was just it was sort of like all of us. I needed a place. It's like John wanted a computer. I mean, I wanted a place where I could go and talk to other people, and it really just came out of that. There wasn't much of an influence. I mean, I either looked in one of the magazines, maybe it was yours or something, where here's a list of all the computer societies. It was maybe a half a dozen at the time, or maybe 10, and no one was in Philly, and so that's how it really started.
So because I look through Creative Computing every single month, look for where the first PAX was listed, and that's where I saw the Southern California Computer Society actually had a group in Philadelphia, and I just was interested to know if anybody was a member of that, or if anybody even knew that it was that happened, or were they just throwing a satellite out to make it look like they were a national group?
You know, I do recall that they were trying to form. I mean, they were probably one of the biggest ones, obviously, and they were trying to form some other. I guess they were affiliates in different cities. It's just coming back now, but they didn't really influence us.
Do you remember, by the way, in Philadelphia?
David, do you have anything to add?
There was Bill Gates visited Philadelphia.
Oh, sure, yeah.
Remember that?
Yeah, he was visited when I was still the president, I think. And
that's when I first met Bill Gates.
I have a copy of a Word manual autographed by him.
I remember meeting Bill Gates at that show, and he was just standing around, and we must have talked for about a half an hour about things that, and I thought, he's so young.
Well, they were actually trying to publicize Microsoft, and actually went around a lot of the early computer shows, and they would they were great because they came in and said, well, you know, we want to provide lunch for your society. I'm going, sign us up. We're sort of more interested in the food than hearing about Microsoft, you know. And well, sure, you want to come and talk? Yeah, that's good. But feed us.
So, in the beginning, did I know that Moss contributed across the chips? Yeah. Who else was involved?
Yeah, Will Mathis was very instrumental, and he became very close with the company that developed the, I guess, 6502s is what he did. So we were sort of very oriented towards that, because their plant was right out in. Outside of Philly.
Okay. This is a question for you, Dave. In all the years that people have been writing about the homebrew era of computing, what do you think they've missed? What's left to learn about this era? Try to keep that to 5 minutes.
No. How can you say what people have overlooked or missed? I mean, even from a historian's standpoint, you look back and say, oh, well, you know, we should have thought about this, we should have thought about that. But on the other hand, there's also things that happen where the same development happens simultaneously in different places.
Yeah.
And we see why, because there's through history, there becomes a time where this is the right thing. And computers were, or personal computers were, the right thing. I go back to digital equipment, I was heading up the educational group, and occasionally an engineer, like one of these guys or one of you, would want a computer. Well, digital didn't really have a computer to sell to an individual. They have PDP 11, but you know, who's going to come up with $10,000 to have a computer in their basement or something? And people were digging parts out of discarded parts out of dumpsters and stuff, and trying to build stuff. And Steve Gray had the Amateur Computer Society newsletter that told people how to put some of this stuff together. But there was a desire to have a computer. And occasionally somebody would come to us, to Deck, that did have enough money, and he wanted to buy one. Well, Deck wasn't prepared to sell him one and to provide the support after they got the computer. So they occasionally would sell one, and they'd look to us, the education group, because we were dealing with the lowest level customers, to deal with these people. And we did. And I can count on two hands how many people bought computers from Deck. There weren't very many.
You did come out with the LSI 11.
Put it in.
Yeah. But what we did as a result of that is I moved from the education group over to an R&D group, and we built a couple of small computers, PDP 8A. It was on a single board. We took an 11 and the 1120. You remember that, the 19-inch rack? Well, we built an 1110. It was a tiny version of the 11. Packaged it with a monitor and basically we put the 8A into a VT05 terminal and said, here's a whole self-contained computer. We can sell it for $4,000 or $5,000. We brought these two things.
$4,000 or $5,000. How much today?
That was a lot.
I mean, that's like a $50,000 car versus back then.
Yes, exactly. Exactly. But okay, so we did build two prototypes. And remember, there weren't floppy disks. We were talking about floppy disks. We had this disk from our Swiss development people that was kind of a 7-inch disk, and it was magnetic, and it was a forerunner of a floppy disk. We put that in with the 11, PDP 11 system. So we had these two systems, brought it to the operations committee of digital equipment, and put them out there. They're working, they're nice systems. The marketing people said, yes, yes, this is we need these. And the finance people said, yeah, we're just coming out of a recession. To devote another production line to something new, a little shaky on that. Manufacturing people said, oh, no, we can make it. We can make these things. And basically, the operations committee of DEC was split right down the middle. Half the people wanted half. So it came to Ken Olson. We just gave a little remembrance of, but Ken Olson said, I don't see any reason for an individual to have a computer of his own. I just don't see it.
Most famous quote.
Yeah, it's a very famous quote. He repeated it again a couple of years later at the World Future Society Convention in Boston. But the reason, and to give Ken his due, he was thinking, hey, you can take a terminal with a nice telephone, modem, and hook it up and get to a PDP 10 big time sharing machine, have a lot of computer power in your home. You don't want to have a computer of your own. So, that was the trade-off as far as he was concerned. But the point is that the desire, though, was there to have a computer. This meeting, by the way, with the operations committee where we brought these two computers was on my birthday. Actually, which is a couple days from now, May 17th, 1974. 74, I'm sorry. 74. Had DEC said, yes, let's build one, they would have owned the personal computer market, absolutely owned it. Instead, we had to wait until the end of that year, until, you know.
How much were they selling it for?
Well, 5,000.
Out there would have owned it.
No, except that was, that was 5,000 with 8K of memory.
Wow.
And a real terminal. A video terminal. So anyway, the desire though was there, and that's what I see happening.
Was there any reaching out? Like, it seems like there's an overemphasis on the California side, the Apple story,
California,
the Microsoft story. There were things like Xitan and TDL and all these other companies. Are there any companies that you could think of that you thought were going to make it coming out of our area, New Jersey?
Well, it wasn't just California and the East Coast. You had the Southwest Technical Product in San Antonio area. There was a development, Ohio Scientific. There was a lot of stuff going on up in Boston. But there was kind of and even in Southern California, there's actually, in the beginning, there was more in Southern than there was up in what became Silicon Valley. It's just kind of an inertia, critical mass. They got to a critical mass out in Silicon Valley.
But we kept going through this process of, why would you want a computer in your home? You have no idea the amount of flack that I took from normal people is, you have a computer in your home?
Well, having a computer store, people would walk in out of curiosity, and being one of the salespeople myself, they would say, what do I want a computer for? And I answered that question, or I heard that question.
Recipes.
5 times a day, right? The recipes and automation and this and that. But I learned another answer, which turned out to be the truth. And I said to people, I said, if you don't know why you want a computer, I'm not sure why you're here. Yeah. But if you just want a computer and you don't know what you want to do with it, buy it, take it home, play with it, and you'll learn. And you'll come back in 6 months and you'll tell me what you're doing with it. It will be nothing we've ever talked about before. Because it's really, like Steve Jobs quoted many, many years ago, it's a power tool for your mind. It's going to make you be able to do different things that you couldn't do before. And fortunately, you know, many people did that. They took it home. And I used to meet people years after to tell me they were doing this and they were doing that. There was one guy who bought our computer and wrote a programming language with it, a compiler, an interpreter, a database system. He made it into a big computer. So who knows what you can do with it. Even today, I bought this iPad the other day. I have no idea what I'm going to do with it. I have no idea, but I'm having fun learning.
But we've got some questions. We have a half hour so left, 20 minutes, half hour left. So why don't we field some questions? You want to start, and then we'll get you next, okay?
First, thanks for all being here. We really, really appreciate it. My question is, you know, whenever we read about history, there was Silicon Valley, there was the 128 corridor in Boston, and we know what the influences were up there, MIT, Stanford, etc. But here in New Jersey, we weren't doing too shabby. Yeah, the whole Bell Labs, all the AT&T, you had Fort Monmouth military ecosystem, you had Princeton University, we had Claude Kagan doing Resistors Club, right?
Right.
Yes, Claude here, by the way.
He's around, he's floating. And just recently, we were organizing our museum library, and we've had hundreds of books that said property of Fort Monmouth. And a lot of them were, you know, Introduction to Automatic Computers, 1953. But then we found, you know, Basic for Your VIC-20. And we're like, why is Fort Monmouth buying this? And books about artificial intelligence and game theory and, you know, interfacing RS-232 and what is Fort Monmouth? So my question is, other than just the hobbyist influence, what did you guys see? Were you getting any business customers interested in these toy computers in 1975? Or was it just individuals?
I can answer that somewhat.
I think you did have business people.
Yeah, we had business people that sometimes they came by accident. We sold a computer to the Philadelphia Spectrum to run their scoreboard. They're assigned in the middle of the arena, which had lights on all the sides of it. And the way they were making signs for it was some graphic designer was punching up some paper tape, running it through a paper tape reader, and they were getting signs on it. Well, they called us for whatever reason, and we interfaced our CompuColor color computer 8-bit port to their 8-bit card, 8-bit paper tape reader, and now we was able to do full motion graphics. It was like a dramatic thing. Their cost from us was about $10,000. The next competing bid was $150,000. And they were in love with it till they tore the stadium down. We had Burroughs Automation up in Watchung that were building flat panel displays, and they needed the computer to be able to send data to the flat panel display, read it, and make sure that it came back the same way they sent it. And we designed something, and it was a standard MSI computer. Well, yeah, one of our people write a program, and they did it. We sold to Western Electric parts that we bought from Western Electric, which was a lot of fun. People were learning how to use them, but by and large, I got to say that 90% of the business was hobbyists who were really, really learning new stuff.
Let me just add one quickie. I happened to work, my first job when I got out of the Army was with a little company called Management Science Associates in Pittsburgh. That was a spinoff of Carnegie Mellon University, where I got my master's degree. And I worked for a professor there at the company. He left the university and started this little company. And one of our first contracts was with the Spectrum Arena. And we did the paper tape programming. In 1968. So that's why it was paper tape. Yeah.
Now, David, coming from DEC like you did, integrated computing, you knew inside information from the DEC perspective. Were you the only one, or were other DEC people and your competitors, IBM, other Univac, saying, he's crazy going out with those hippie toy companies, stick with real computers? Like, what was their impression of what you were doing inside those companies?
Oh, DEC thought that these small computers were, small computers, useless. Not useless, but just,
on the fringe.
Yeah, that was definitely on the fringe. And our DEC's biggest competitor was actually Hewlett-Packard on the West Coast. And they pretty much had the same thing. Wozniak went to Hewlett-Packard with a proposal to produce the Apple, and Hewlett-Packard said,
more point about that. So when we were doing our museum library organizing a few weeks ago, we came across the early issues of the People's Computer Company newsletter from 1972.
Yeah, Bob Albrecht.
And they were sponsored by HP.
Yes.
So you had HP on one side, you and I talked about this on the phone recently, HP on one side being big company, turning down Steve Wozniak's opportunity to build a computer, and HP on the other side supporting the People's Computer Company. And they were bipolar.
Well, yeah, but bear in mind, DEC, we had this at DEC, EduMagazine, but that was aimed at the education market, and so was People's Computer Company. It was aimed at the education market. It was not initially aimed at individual hobbyists. It became a hobbyist thing. I mean, Albrecht started the, what were those storefront computer centers, which
community
I guess
memory.
You also called People's Computer Company.
Yeah, community memory.
And Stuart Brand and all of those guys.
Were,
Stein,
were
by the way, what did DEC feel about Bill Gates and his buddy Paul Allen ripping off DEC Basic? Wasn't that DEC Basic that they had?
Okay,
it
was Nate Teicholz that developed the BASIC, and actually DEC...
That was one of their first big...
Well, except that DEC didn't have a DEC BASIC. DEC in the late 60s was actually wedded to Focal. I don't know how many of you remember Focal. Focal,
I just got it running on an 8S.
There you go. Focal was in a sense, it was a more efficient language to BASIC, single letters actually instead of words, although it would recognize a word and just truncate the rest of it. But then BASIC came along, developed by John Kemeny and Tom Kurtz up at Dartmouth on a General Electric computer, and then they said, well, Hewlett-Packard expressed some interest in it, and so it wasn't until my group at DEC in 1970, and we're trying to sell computers to schools, and with Focal on it, and the schools are saying, we want BASIC.
Yeah, basically.
They were sold on that by Dartmouth and so I said, we've got to have BASIC. And our group actually contracted with an outside contractor, totally outside of DEC, to develop BASIC for the PDP-8. Now, I'm talking about writing programs in a small amount of space. We had 4K of memory on the 8. The BASIC compiler and operating system took 3.5K. That gave you 500 8-bit words to write your programs in. And by the way, that's what the original, my original lunar lander program run. It took 498 words, 8-bit words to run. The Hammurabi program. Oh, anyway, so that was not a DEC product. It was written by an outside vendor. DEC resold it. The DEC BASIC that Nate Teicholz developed was sort of similar, although it was endorsed by the PDP-11 group, but it wasn't the same. By 1974, DEC was selling 6 different versions of BASIC, which is why that early games book is so difficult, because some of them were written for a multi-user, 4-user system on a PDP-8. Some were used written for the single user. Some were written for the PDP-11. Some were written for the PDP-10. They're all different. They're all different BASIC. None of them were DEC BASIC. So they didn't care.
I thought BASIC was supposed to be a standard.
Well, yeah, that's the other
nice thing about standards. Is
everybody has their deviance.
And since BASIC was originally developed at an educational institution, Kemeny and Kurtz developed it, there was no questions of, it's a proprietary thing.
Any questions? Well, you actually, you're you and then you, okay.
Well, I just want to introduce myself. I'm Victor Nahiki, and I'm new to the group. I was one of the 10 people that got a PDP-8 back in 1972 from Digital. And we rolled it in the back of our car, and we brought it to my basement, and the electric company came in and ran a 3-phase wire, and it worked real well. So thank you. And with that, I helped write a bunch of game books. My question to Dave is,
he's acknowledged in the
as an 11-year-old kid back then. And so Dave actually got me started. Someone opened up the book and said to my dad, you can write games, program for me. And he said, that's my 12-year-old son. Dave, do you ever think of yourself as a revolutionary? These kids now play Xbox games, PlayStation. How do you feel you contributed to that?
Well, obviously, basic computer games being the first, as they say, million-selling computer book, had some influence, obviously, on people playing games with computers. But again, I go back to the whole idea of, if I didn't do it, Albrecht would have, somebody else would have. He had a book of games. It was time. That was something you could do with computers.
Yeah.
Play games. So people wanted to play games.
I'll never forget the game of Adventure, which was a console game
that
you played on a teletype. And then in 1989, Nintendo came out with Zelda. And I started playing Zelda, and I said, that's my adventure game with pictures.
But you know what? Recently on, anybody watched The Big Bang Theory?
Yeah.
What's his name? The kid, Jim Bob Sheldon. He's at his computer. And these guys are really into big computers. And he's playing. You're standing at the end of a road. You look east. That's the opening of Adventure.
Yeah.
You've never seen it before.
And they recently had Woz made an appearance on a show.
Oh, I didn't see that.
Yeah, Steve was on.
But to see Adventure come around in 2013, It freaked me out.
We used to sit around playing Adventure on the teletype and said, wouldn't it be cool if you could really see the dwarf throw the axe, you know? and then Nintendo went and did it, you know?
Okay, you have a question?
Yeah, first of all, thanks a lot, guys. This has been just an incredibly exciting forum. Do you have any recollections about the emergence of the BBS scene? Because when you guys all got gobsmacked by, you know, seeing the Altair on the cover of Popular Crime, you know, you were all islands to some extent. So you had to have the fairs, you had to have the magazines. At what point did these computers start reaching out and talking to
them? I want to make a comment about something like that. In our Valdox system that I talked about in 1983, 84, we designed it. We started in 82, by the way, with the hardware design of the QX10. 83 was a lot of the software development, and 84 was basically the year that we released it. But one of the elements of our software was something called email, or a mail program. And the way it worked is if you were running Valdox and you had a modem and you left your computer on, you could send and receive mail from all over the country. We had an inbox, the time that the mail came in, you double click on it, or you not click on it, but you selected that, and you could see the mail you got. And we thought email was going to be a big thing. Turned out it wasn't so big. But we thought it was going to be. And in reality, it was. Maybe the time wasn't quite right, like you're saying. But I thought email was going to be really hot.
I would like to mention, I visited the Atlantic City computer show, and what I remember was one guy feeding 8-inch disks into a Model 2 TRS-80 and was connected to a speaker and would actually play a melody. And he was feeding those 8-inch disks like at the rate of about every 10 seconds.
We should let tell about that first Philadelphia Music Festival.
You know, Dave, I think you deserve a lot more credit than you're giving yourself with this, because I think it goes back to the comment you made about what do people actually... So it's sort of like, what do you do with a computer? And I think what you did was open people's eyes in terms of the creative aspects of it with, you know, the people that couldn't see, you know, I spent all this money to balance my checkbook. I mean, that wasn't really flying. But the creative aspects, I think, reached a whole segment of people that couldn't that just open their eyes to doing things different. But that the guy you mentioned was a guy named Hal Chamberlain from North Carolina that wrote a book on the first book on computer music that Veit published actually. But what we did was when John moved the computer show to Philadelphia from Atlantic City, he called me up and he said, well, you know, since you're the head of the Computer Society in Philly, do you guys want to do something, you know, sort of host something or anything? And I had some friends that were doing some stuff with the computers and the arts. And I remember telling John, well, John, why don't we put on a computer music concert? And I remember there was silence on the other end of the phone, you know? It was like, you want to do what? And so we ended up doing this, and we put an ad in the paper. So we got a bunch of people together, which the album came out of it, but we put an article in the Inquirer, and it said, come to this, we're going to have it at this hotel at some evening, and, you know, it was like nobody even knew what this was. So we had all the people inside this room that we rented, and we had a lot of technical problems. We're setting it up, we're probably about a half hour late starting the thing. We opened the doors, and there was a line of people all the way out the hotel, you know, out into the sidewalk to get into this thing. And we couldn't even fit them all in the room. But that sort of, you know, it goes back to, like, what were people thinking about doing this? They go, wow, you know, computers and arts. And Hal was up there, and we learned something really really interesting then is people come to a computer music concert, and, you know, they hear the music, but the visuals were lacking. I mean, so you see this guy throwing this in the computer thing. So some guy took an oscilloscope and had a lens and projected that, you know, so just the waveforms of the music, and that sort of became the graphics. And then we turned it into a computer and graphics, you know, and
we had a dazzle.
The one, yeah, yeah.
We don't do things like that.
And then we formed a group called SCAN, Small Computers in the Arts Network, and that grew and went for 20 years. And we had Timothy Leary was a keynote speaker. He got into this stuff, and Todd Rundgren, all these people came in because it was
came to my store, by the way, early on.
Yeah, because they were all the creative side was getting into this because it just unlocked.
I had no idea who he was, and one of my technicians came back and said, "You know who that is?" Yeah. I said, "No." He had like a feathery red thing in his hair, and wearing gold lace. He came in a limousine.
Yeah.
And he had a young guy with him who was his computer guy, and they were looking for all the Apple stuff because they were into. This is before computer music was really computer music. These guys were forerunners.
Yep.
Peter Paul and Mary got involved.
Yeah. Here's Dick's original comments written in 1978 between Dick and John about that computer music festival. By the way, if anybody did my commercial pitch wants a copy of this. I've got remastered ones on CD, and you get a little explanation and so on, but these are $5.
Cool. Evan, you were looking at me like you want to do the drawing.
Yeah, I have a couple of nothings and a prize.
Okay.
So, first of all, how about a big hand of applause to these guys?